Welcome to the Athanasius lecture. If you could find a seat toward the front, the acoustics are better. We are delighted you are joining us this evening. It's our first Athanasius lecture of the semester, and we are having two more. The next is given by Dr. Kibbe, and that will be on March 18th. He tells us he's covering the first two chapters of Hebrews, so that'll be interesting. Then we have another guest speaker, Dr. Gerald Sitzer, on April 21st. He's faculty at the University, Wilbert Worth University. He's written 8 books on his interests in theology and church engagement. So that'll be really intriguing. So Anastasia's our only student for this semester. So, yeah. All right, so Anastasia is a senior at Moody Bible Institute here in Spokane. She's graduating in May with her Bachelor of Arts in Biblical Studies. After she graduates, Anastasia plans to live in Spokane and get involved with a nonprofit organization that is bettering the community. She began learning about Augustine's theology of sexuality her first year at Moody, and her interest has been picked since. She hopes that the conversation tonight on sexual difference will be enlightening, grace-filled, and promote further conversation. So before we begin, I'd like to open with a word of prayer. So, dear Lord and Father, thank you that you know each of us by name and are present both among us and in each and one of us as we are gathered here tonight. Help us by our presence at this Athanasius lecture to understand more about your creation and the way that you have made us as individuals. We ask for your guidance, wisdom, and clarity for Anastasia as she speaks tonight and for each of us as we listen. Help us to engage in a meaningful conversation about you and the identity we find in you. Draw us to pursue you and your truth for your glory and for the strengthening of our community. We ask that the Holy Spirit would lead our conversations tonight and that our hearts and minds would be conformed to your holiness in all our thoughts and deeds. Above all, Lord, help us to really know you, the source of all wisdom. Use this Athanasius lecture tonight for your honor and glory. In your name I pray, amen. Would you welcome Anastasia Hall for her presentation?
One of the most fundamental aspects to our experience as human beings is that which pertains to our sexuality. Intrinsic to our nature, relevant to people of all ages throughout every era, sexuality encompasses who we are at our very core. It deals with a part of us that we find to be so central to our human experience. Within the broader conversation of sexuality is the question of sexual difference, which we could summarize in asking, what is it that makes us male and female? Are these arbitrary terms given to humanity to merely address our biological differences, or might they signify something more? Could we ask questions about the topic than have typically been asked and dig deeper into the theological framework of those questions? In this difficult conversation, we find one who can help us navigate through some of these crucial theological inquiries. St. Augustine. Augustine has proved to be a catalyst for how the church would come to think of some of the most important doctrines in the centuries that followed. From his warring against Pelagianism to developing the doctrines of predestination, his works have greatly assisted the church in its defense of orthodoxy. During the 4th century, he was known for addressing various heresies and obstacles that arose in the church, and also for explaining the foundational elements of the Christian faith. Just as Augustine shed light on important issues in his own time, so now his voice proves to be pertinent for contemporary issues we face. This is particularly true as we begin to dialogue about sexual differences. Augustine will serve as a great resource in maneuvering through this topic. Using Augustine as our reference point, this lecture will seek to uncover the theological significance of sexual differences in creation, the earthly pilgrimage, and the eschaton, in hopes of developing a more holistic and well-rounded theology of sexuality. There are two primary streams of thought that are currently flowing through the evangelical church in regards to sexuality and more specifically sexual difference. The first could be deemed the more conservative of the two. The stream will often proof text to support their arguments against homosexuality while thinking the discussion ends here. This group is more difficult to attribute specific individuals to, as it is more likely to be found in the underlying presupposition of many American evangelicals. While these very scriptural passages may condemn homosexuality, they may not necessarily theologically answer questions about sexual difference. In other words, Romans 1 may speak negatively of homosexuality, but it does not explain why sexual difference is important. The second stream of thought that is prominent in the evangelical church concerning sexuality will emphasize acceptance and autonomy to explain why same-sex marriage should be welcomed by the church. This group is more liberal in their thinking, and some would say it relies on experience rather than scripture. One of the primary proponents of this is the Anglican tradition, which allows gay lay people, though gay clergy are expected to remain abstinent. One of the strongest voices in the Anglican tradition is Reverend Broderick Greer, an advocate for those who are Christian and gay. The language and arguments which liberalism holds to when it comes to homosexuality and marriage fail to align with how the church has historically talked about such matters. This group will tend to form new concepts on the topic of sexuality rather than delve into how Christians have historically thought about it. It neither uses scriptural nor theological categories to explain why homosexuality should be embraced by the church. In sum, the modern evangelical church in America simply does not have a theological vocabulary for articulating why it is important that people are sexually different. However, one can be sure that there are much better ways of thinking through the topic of sexual difference. There are many conversations taking place within the larger Christian context, which can greatly aid us in our discovery of the topic. The first one, which was particularly enlightening for me when researching Augustine's theology of sexual difference, is Christopher Roberts' Creation and Covenant, the significance of sexual difference in the moral theology of marriage. The structure which I will use for my paper tonight in Augustine's threefold narrative of sexual difference was borrowed from Roberts' book, wherein he does a much more helpful job than I can do of depicting this. Further study also includes William Loder's New Testament on Sexuality, and Washed and Waiting by Wesley Hill. These authors have done far more than I'm doing here, and I would encourage you to utilize their research and study. It is at this point that one may ask, why does it matter that we have theological categories for speaking about sexuality? Firstly, sexuality is intrinsic to our nature. It is one of the most fundamental and basic aspects to our humanity. We see this demonstrated in the creation of man and woman in the Garden of Eden. Genesis 1:27 reads, "So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them." And similarly, the gospel writer Mark notes, "But from the beginning, God made them male and female." As the scriptures indicate, from the beginning of creation, God has made humanity with having sexes. Our sexuality is something that has been instilled in us by God from the dawn of creation. We recognize and agree then that sexuality is rudimentary to mankind's existence. As such, it is both helpful to us and necessary for our faith to create theological categories to understand our sexuality. Let me begin by stating that this lecture is not intended to supply ammunition for one's argument. Along with Christopher Roberts' goal in his book Creation and Covenant, I stand in hearty agreement that the theologian's foremost task is not to retrieve ammunition for today's combatants. Only then, when one has looked at the tradition in its own right and from a more disinterested perspective, can one return to the present debates. Only then can this book, or lecture, hope to offer resources and better questions for the present. Oliver O'Donovan noted that the task of the theologian is not simply to engage in the debate on the side that appears to have the greater right. It is to safeguard the gospel integrity of the debate by clarifying what the questions are that must be at issue. I want to encourage us all at this time to open our hearts to the truth of the Word of God as we discuss sexuality and strive to converse graciously with one another. This topic, by nature, is deeply connected to who we are as individuals. Let us come with the charity of Christ as we discuss this. For simplicity's sake, perhaps a brief definition of sexuality as well as gender is in order. Sexuality primarily deals with the male and femaleness of an individual in their biological makeup. This could be equivocated with the biblical terms male and female. Gender, on the other hand, is generally the language by which someone takes a masculine or feminine identity. It is the outworking of this behavior within a certain social context. For the purposes of this paper, we will strictly speak of sexual difference in regards to the former, sexuality. Many have claimed that Augustine of Hippo was one of the greatest thinkers and saints in the church's history. Known for his vast knowledge on an array of theological subjects, St. Augustine has been a backbone of the church since early 4th century. His biblical insight and theological mindset has given Christians all around the world understanding to difficult matters facing the church throughout the centuries. Among the 5 million words written by Augustine, he touched on the topic of sexuality. His influence on how the church would come to think of sexuality is profound. One scholar writes that the underlying theological rationale for much of traditional Catholic teaching on sexuality is derived from Augustine's writings. Unlike other topics, Augustine did not dedicate a great series of works or sermons to the topic. Rather, he interspersed his thoughts on sexuality throughout his commentaries and sermons. What is clear from the little that Augustine did write on sexuality, however, is that it is extremely significant in the life of the Christian. Just like other aspects of his theology, Augustine believed that sexuality is intricately tied to the greater story of the Christian life. Sexuality for Augustine was an important facet in the Christian narrative. Augustine saw sexuality affecting three major categories in the Christian life, which will provide a basic outline for this paper: the fall, the earthly pilgrimage, and eschatology. These categories are derived from Christopher Roberts' Creation and Covenant, The Significance of Sexual Difference in the Moral Theology of Marriage. Augustine himself did not put such categories into place. For Augustine, he understood sexuality to have theological significance, not only in the present life, but also looking back on creation and forward into eternity. He believed that God's purposes for sexual difference were not meaningless, but rather as an essential part of God's plan for his creation from the beginning. Let's begin by observing a text wherein Augustine addresses his theology of sexual difference in creation. The first of Augustine's commentaries on Genesis, entitled On Genesis Against the Manichaeans, was written in 388 or 389. This commentary was written in response to the Manichaeans, who disregarded the Christian understanding of who God was based on their notions that he was materialistic and anthropomorphic. The Manichaeans would have understood texts such as Genesis 1:26, "Let us make mankind in our own image," as proof that God was limited and changeable, as with a human body. Augustine sets out here to show the Manichaeans that scripture ought not to be read with such wooden literalism, but rather ought to be seen more fluidly. How are Augustine's ideas of sexual difference suggested in his commentary against the Manichaeans? For Augustine, he saw the potential of sexual difference representing the relationship between an individual's rational understanding and his or her flesh. In other words, the creation of man and woman in Genesis, for Augustine, was symbolic for or representative of the two wills within a single person, one which has the right to govern and one which has to be governed. He writes, "In this way, what can be seen more clearly in two human beings, that is, in male and female, may be considered in a single person, that the interior mind, like the manly reason, should have as its subject the soul's appetite or desire, through which we put the limbs and parts of the body to work, and by a just law should keep its help within bounds, just as a man ought to govern his wife." Though Augustine notes that the woman being made in the body of man could have been a literal true event in the creation story, he notes that it was surely not without reason that she was made like that. It must have been to suggest some hidden truth. Augustine wants to look beyond the historical making of man and woman and understand what it could signify, which he thought to be the two wills within a person. Augustine believed that when Adam greets Eve with the statement, "Bone out of my bones and flesh from my flesh," that a hierarchical relationship is revealed between the masculine and feminine. This relationship between the male and female is one of superiority and inferiority, one which gives orders and one which obeys. This serves as an illustration for Augustine of what takes place within an individual. Two wills, one which submits to the other. Thus, sexual difference in the creation story paints a picture for what is true of every person, the internal struggle between the rational understanding of a person and his or her flesh. Again, Augustine would not have ignored the literal making of man and woman, but rather would have thought that this pointed to a greater reality which takes place within a single person. When this occurs within an individual, spiritual fruit is produced. Roberts notes, there is a spiritual fecundity issuing in divine praise in Eden's ordering of the two sexes whenever a person's interior life is rightly ordered. It is by this mutual compatibility between the two wills that spiritual offspring can be produced, a soul whose interior life is rightly ordered. How is Augustine's theology of sexual difference seen in On Genesis against the Manichaeans? It is seen in a reading of the text that for Augustine depicts not merely the literal making of man and woman, but also as a symbolic illustration of the internal struggle of wills in each individual. The making of man and woman, the creation of sexual differences, points to a greater reality between beyond two people being formed. This reading affects each and every person, male or female, and places its focus on the interior state of one's soul. In focusing so greatly on the internal wills within a person, one wonders if the other aspects of sexual difference could be lost, namely the physical sexed body. With external effects of sexual difference being a reality that we face every day, does Augustine's illustration fail to capture the full picture of sexuality? By saying that all people struggle internally in the same respect in relation to the wills, does Augustine minimize the importance of actual differences that exist? In the literal commentary on Genesis, Augustine further develops his theology of sexual difference in the creation story. A work dated between 393 and 395, it was left unfinished by Augustine. From this work, one can infer an implicit opinion about sexual difference from Augustine's comments about the Imago Dei. For Augustine, the image of God placed within every individual is the innermost and principal element in humanity, which he takes to be the mind, which holds the leading place in human nature. And what of the other aspects of humanity, which one could infer from Augustine, includes the sexed body? Augustine writes, though beautiful in their kind, they are still common to us and animals, and therefore in us are to be prized chiefly. Thus, Augustine saw the image of God primarily displayed in the human mind and believed that the other human characteristics, though beautiful, should not be looked to for holding significant human or theological meaning. In sum, sexual difference for Augustine is not a place where significant human meaning resides because the Imago Dei exists primarily in the mind of the individual. Thus concludes our discussion evaluating Augustine's perspective on theology, on theological significance in the creation account. What can we conclude? Firstly, on Genesis against the Manichaeans, we see that sexual difference for Augustine has primarily allegorical and spiritual significance. Though he would not negate the external characteristics of sexual difference, here Augustine will see the creation account through a typological lens. The relationship between man and woman in this text reveals a greater picture of an individual's rational will and the fleshly will. Secondly, in the literal commentary on Genesis, we are able to draw inferences from Augustine's theology of the Imago Dei in the mind. His reference to the other aspects of humanity being of lesser importance than the than the image of God shows us that sexual difference is not the pinnacle of human existence. In the creation account, Augustine wants to portray sexual difference as signifying more than the mere physical sexed body. The first work we'll observe in which Augustine addresses sexual difference during the earthly pilgrimage, meaning during one's time on earth, is in his commentary on Galatians. This work briefly addresses Galatians 3:28, which reads, "There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is no male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus." Augustine takes this to mean that in regards to spirituality, there is no distinction between male and female. In Christ, there is one baptism, and all are belonging to Abraham's seed. There is no distinction of sexual difference in Christ, something we can term spiritual androgyny. However, in the present life, sexual difference is a very present reality and must be embraced as such. Robert summarizes Augustine's thoughts on this, that in the present life, there is an order to be observed on this life's journey that is taught by the apostles, who hand down very salutary rules as to how Christians should live together with regard to differences of people, Jews and Greeks, status, masters and slaves, sex, husbands and wives, and the like. And it is also the teaching of the Lord himself, who said earlier, "Give to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." In other words, sexual differences are apparently overcome in social life from an eschatological perspective, but like Caesar, they persist for the time being and merit respect as part of a legitimate secular order. For Christians, the sexes are not differentiated in that everyone has Christ as the head of the common body. All are one in Christ and receive the inheritance through faith, but they remain differentiated in the life God wishes for mortals as natural creatures. Just as one ought to give to Caesar the things that are Caesar's for the time being, as a recognition of certain social constructs in the present life, so one must accept sexual difference as a reality in the earthly pilgrimage. Though as Christians we acknowledge that soteriologically speaking there is no sexual differentiation, we remain differentiated in this life. Augustine acknowledges sexual differences in the present life while at the same time affirming sexual oneness in Christ. The second work, which we'll observe of Augustine's in regard to sexual difference in the earthly pilgrimage, is his book, Confessions. Perhaps Augustine's most popular work, we see here a type of autobiography, an overview of Augustine's childhood, adolescence, adulthood, and conversion. In book 8 of his Confessions, we see Augustine uphold sexual equality while affirming a hierarchical relationship between man and woman. He writes, "And as in his soul there's one element which deliberates and aspires to domination, and another element which is submissive and obedient, so in the bodily realm, woman is made for man. In mental power, she has equal capacity of rational intelligence, but by the sex of her body, she is submissive to the masculine sex. This is analogous to the way in which the impulse of action is subordinate to the rational mind's prudent concern that the act is right." So we see that each particular point and the whole taken together are very good. For Augustine, bodily there is a hierarchy, while mentally there is equality. Thus, the difference Augustine sees between the sexes is only in the external bodily aspects of a human person, that is, the differences of mortal flesh. In regard to mental capacity and capability, including reason and the will, there is complete equality of the sexes. Moving further and deeper into Confessions, one cannot help but note the significance of sexuality in Augustine's own life. The struggles and yearnings that Augustine faced pre-conversion were engulfed in sexual trysts, as he often references the entrapment he experienced during this time. It was Augustine's involvement with promiscuity that he later admits kept him from embracing Christianity wholeheartedly. He writes that he was unable to think of a life wherein he was not dominated by his lust for women. Quote, "I believed continence to be achieved by personal resources that I was not aware of possessing, and it was out of my power to live a celibate life." Augustine saw himself very much so in bondage to his appetite, and thereby unable to serve and love God as he ought. Augustine writes, "The single desire which dominated my search for delight was simply to love and to be loved, but no restraint was imposed by the exchange of mind with mind, which marks the brightly lit path of friendship. Clouds of muddy carnal concupiscence filled the air. The bubbling impulses of puberty befogged and obscured my heart so that it could not see the difference between love's serenity and lust's darkness. Confusion of the two things boiled within me." For Augustine, sexuality represented confusion, chaos, and divergence from the ultimate love. C.S. Lewis summed up Augustine's view of the repercussions of the fall on the sexual life of man by stating that man has called for anarchy. God lets him have it. It would be long before Augustine would come to see sexuality as what it was truly designed to be by God, a glorious part of creation wherein one is pointed to the true and better lover. Augustine was able to look back on his life filled with lust and depict it as evil precisely because it was a giving up of the best for a lesser good. Note that Augustine does not condemn the desire to love and to be loved, but rather states that this love is so powerful that it leads to an intoxication with the creation rather than the creator. Augustine does not attack one's desire to love, but rather notes the entrapment that one can face in this. A perversion takes place when one prefers what was made to the maker. Roberts notes that the problem with the sexual appetite, with lust, is precisely this loss of moderation, abandoning the higher and supreme goods, replacing love for God with passion for the bottom end of the scale of good. Augustine notes that the sensually passionate cannot see that there are no caresses tenderer than your God's charity, and no object of love is more healthy than your truth, beautiful and luminous beyond all things. Therefore, in confession, sexual difference is a physical feature, but it is related to potential spiritual chaos, and it has great power to overwhelm and distort. It's also important to note in our discussion of Augustine's theology of sexual difference that he believed that the celibate lifestyle is also a viable option for the Christian. Augustine sees this as sometimes fitting for the Christian because it is a way of life that unifies the loves of an individual. When we restrain ourselves sexually, we appear to the Holy Spirit for help and are drawn upwards in a love of freedom from anxiety. He notes, however, that continence is so difficult that one must be aided by the grace of God to carry it out. On this, he writes most famously, "O charity, my God, set me on fire. You command continence. Grant what you command and command what you will." Augustine recognized that God had the potential to accomplish in a sinful person what he or she could not. It is when we are transformed by God to be continent that our inner lives become rightly ordered. On this, Roberts writes, "Continence is Augustine's proposal for the most fruitful way of managing the tensions of sexual difference by appealing to a love that transcends these differences." What can we say of Augustine's theology of sexual difference in the earthly pilgrimage account? We saw in his commentary on Galatians that there is no sexual distinction in Christ as believers, but that we are all one in Christ. He does, however, note that sexual difference is a reality during the earthly pilgrimage and must be accepted as such during one's time on earth. As for his confessions, Augustine recalls his sensual history and retrospectively sees sexuality as a means for perversion and misordering of loves within an individual. Amid the desire to be loved and to be loved, it is easy for one to become infatuated with the gifts and not the giver. Though sexual difference is a physical feature, it has the power to create spiritual chaos within souls. As we move on from the earthly pilgrimage, let's proceed to dialogue about Augustine's theology of sexual difference in regards to eschatology. The work which we will evaluate is De Civitate Dei, or The City of God. This work, begun in 413 and completed in 426, depicts two cities that exist in the world. In the one city, love of God has been given pride of place, and in the other, love of self.
In these cities, any flourishing and life which is to take place for citizens is rooted in the love on which the city is founded. For Augustine, what we love or desire determines the city to which each of us belongs and the ends for which we act. Central to each city is the love upon which it is built, love of God or love of self. Augustine believed that it is vital that we condemn self-love and cultivate a love for God. He writes, when a man lives according to truth, then he lives not according to self, but according to God. It is because man was created righteous to live according to his maker and not according to himself, doing his maker's will and not his own. Falsehood consists in not living in the way for which he was created. Man does indeed wish to be happy, but he lives in such a way that it is not possible for him to be so. To love ourselves and our own appetites is precisely what Augustine sees as not living in the way for which he was created. It is a turning in on oneself and away from God, living according to himself. In this, man seeks happiness, yet is unable to receive it. Augustine understands this to be what occurred in the creation story when Adam and Eve took of the forbidden fruit. Roberts writes, the fall was a substitution of autonomy for theonomy, an act of loyalty to the human self or earthly city at the expense of obedience to God and citizenship in the heavenly city. Here we understand Augustine's notion of sin. It is when one is infected with this pride that one turns away from obedience to God, solidifying that one's obedience is to the earthly city. With this perspective of human sin, rooted in the pride of self-love rather than in the corporeal realities of creaturehood, Augustine further develops God's intent for creation and how sexual difference fits into this. God's design for humanity, Augustine believed, was for a society which was engulfed in loves which are rightly ordered. This heavenly city that was God's intent for his creation needed to be populated, which would require two protological humans. Augustine writes that the coupling of male and female is the seedbed of it were, as it were, of a city. Male and femaleness, then, would have been a requirement from the beginning of time in order to populate the city, regardless of whether sin had entered the world. Sexual difference, therefore, has always been a cornerstone of the human experience, a requirement from the beginning. It was not as though a need to populate arose later on post-fall. This was something that God had in mind from the beginning. Sexual difference is in many ways founded on God's love for humanity and desire to populate the heavenly city. This is indeed a radically different way of seeing sexual difference as well as procreation. Concerning this, Augustine wrote, "The procreation of children pertains to the glory of marriage, not to the punishment of sin." Sexual difference, then, is a means of bringing about what God had originally intended for the human race, a city wherein each citizen came to embrace and love the God who had created him or her. For Augustine, we see that sexual difference holds theological significance for eschatology because it is through reproduction that one can populate the heavenly city. The heavenly city is where the love of God is celebrated and desired and where the love of self is denied. God's design for humankind is for us to indulge ourselves in him and thereby enter into his plan for creation. God's chosen means of bringing this design into fruition is the bringing together of the two sexes for the purpose of procreation. Sexual difference, therefore, is key to populating the heavenly city, thereby bringing about God's telos for humanity. So, in conclusion, what does Augustine have to say about our modern context in terms of sexuality? How would he encourage Christians today to think about sexual difference in a theological manner? Though it's difficult to say, perhaps that we can infer that Augustine would want us to understand that sexuality is not separate in nature or in conversation from the larger redemption story. Rather, when talking about sexual difference, we must see it in light of creation, the earthly pilgrimage, and eschatology in order to develop a holistic understanding of the topic. Augustine would want us to derive from Against the Manichaeans that sexual difference does not merely pertain to the viable outer differences between man and woman, but points to the relationship between an individual's rational will and one's fleshly will. Sexual difference here represents spiritual realities. Thus, this is not merely a natural conversation. We're dealing with real and pertinent spiritual realities. Thus, this is, he would also want to show us in his commentary on Genesis that the physical body is not the primary means wherein significant human or theological meaning resides, but that this should rather be sought after in the imago Dei of the rational mind. Thus, even when talking of trans and gay people, we should first recognize their worth, as well as ours, is found in being made in the image of God, not in their sexuality. Augustine wouldn't stop here, though. He would also show us that in his commentary on Galatians, that in Christ there is no distinction of sexual difference, which shows us that the most important aspect of humanity exists apart from one's sexuality. Thus, we see that God's foremost priority when one is a new creation is not their sex, but their nature. Augustine would then walk us to his own personal story, which shows us a susceptibility that sexuality has towards the destructive end of spiritual chaos. His Confessions illustrates that though sexual difference is a physical feature, it has great potential for distortion and perversion as it relates to the disordered loves within an individual. Thus, as we speak of the topic of sexual difference, we ourselves should recognize, firstly, that our primordial need for the love of God above love of man, which is constantly being perverted and preferred above love for God. Augustine also recognizes that it is sometimes fitting for the Christian to be celibate, for it is a way of life that unifies the love of an individual. Augustine will go on to take his theology of sexual difference into the future of the unknown, as illustrated in the City of God. In this work, Augustine tells us that God's creation of humanity is for the purpose of placing them in a heavenly city, which, though now marred with sin and pride, can still come to a love of God. This was designed to be done from the beginning of time through procreation, displaying the prelapsarian importance of sexual difference. Thus, sexual difference has the capacity through reproduction to bring about the city of God, thereby fulfilling the telos of humanity. In understanding this dialogue in our own context today, one wonders how Augustine's theology would fit in. Is his holding to sexual difference pertaining mainly to the psychological mind within a person? What would Augustine say of sex changes? For the transgendered person, a sex change can be seen as a solution to inner turmoil that they may be facing. If Augustine saw sexual difference as something that is primarily takes place within the mind of the individual, would he see a sex change operation as being the answer to one's problems, or would he see this as an external fix to an internal issue? Additionally, there's the question of reproduction as a key part to the heavenly city. If, for Augustine, reproduction is one of the most central aspects to this heavenly city, where does the role of those who are unable to produce offspring lie in God's economy? Is Augustine overlooking an important aspect of the human experience? Furthermore, how would Augustine think of same-sex marriage? One may think that he would see this as a disordering of loves, a diversion away from God's creation of sexual differences, an elevation of sexuality above the love of God. The scenarios and situations that we face today concerning sexual difference, though certainly extensive, are not entirely removed from what Augustine was talking about 1,500 years ago. Why is this conversation important for us today in our own culture? It's obvious that the questioning of sexual difference is on the rise. This therefore necessitates that Christians worldwide engage with the question of sexual difference and that we develop a theology that helps us in this endeavor. Augustine shows us that the conversation of sexuality is more nuanced than we often admit and more complicated than how we typically think. We must move deeper into the question of sexual difference and, with Augustine, conclude that there are significant moral questions being asked in this discussion. It is only then that we can hope to helpfully and biblically engage the culture on so important an issue. Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome back, everyone. Go ahead and get started. And first of all, I think Dr. Armstrong had a question for Anastasia, so we'll let him begin.
Welcome, everybody. We're going to try to make our comments brief because we know that you're busting to talk to tonight. So we want to give you some time to do this. Anastasia, thanks for a great presentation. You performed just really beautifully. Thank you for that very lovely presentation. Folks, you want to give it to her again? Haven't heard that one in a while. Thanks. All right. Anastasia, I'm confused. I just got to hand it to you. I'm confused by this. And the Augustine that you presented to me, I'm not sure if I recognize him. So that's what I'm going to ask you. Here's something that C.S. Lewis says in that brilliant preface that he puts to Athanasius's On the Incarnation, that translation. He says, sometimes it's good to read the church fathers, not because we agree with either side, but because it's a fresh perspective. And correct me if I'm wrong, but I think if Augustine were sitting in here, he would say both the conservatives and the liberals on the issue that you mentioned with sexuality are out to lunch. And the problem is both of them fundamentally think that you define human identity by sexuality, or that it's a huge component of human identity. That's where I think Augustine would differ with us, and that's where I think he has a fresh perspective and something to offer to us. So I don't want to hurt your ears, folks, but I got through just a little bit of his treatise on the benefits of marriage, and here's some of the things that Augustine told me. Pardon me for hurting your ears. Augustine is concerned whether male and female is actually a part of created reality or a part of the fall that happens afterwards. He says that the primary virtue of sexuality is procreation. He says that chastity and virginity are a superior state even to marital faithfulness. So reading sort of Paul there in 1 Corinthians 7, literally, if you can be single, do. That's a superior state. This is where it really gets bad. I'm sorry, folks. He says that married people should be celibate if possible. So as married people too, it's best not to have sex, or only to have sex when you think you might conceive. And then lastly, he says it's virtuous to quit sexual relations by mutual consent before old age forces you to do so. So that's the Augustine that I'm used to hearing. And I don't know who this other guy is. What do you think, Anastasia? Have I misread Augustine? Do we have two different figures? How do we harmonize these pictures of Augustine?
Yeah, I think Augustine's operating out of a really different mindset than we are, and coming to the topic of sexuality with a whole different set of presuppositions and thoughts on the matter. And I think what's really key and kind of a common theme throughout each of those concepts that you mentioned is his idea of the interior life of someone being rightly ordered, and that's one of his primary concerns, whether you're celibate or single or married, and the whole idea behind refraining from sexual relations when you're married, what concept of being celibate. He's really deeply concerned with someone being engaged as a citizen in the heavenly city. And that means that the love of God takes precedence over love of self. And so I think that's kind of his driving factor behind a lot of these things and navigating how he's thinking through celibacy and marriage and sexual relations and whether you're married, whether to refrain or... So I think that can help us a little bit understanding why has these bizarre concepts that are really different from how we think about sexuality, is his stress and emphasis on the interior life of someone being rightly ordered.
Thank you, Anastasia. And I'll just ask one very quick other question too. So one of the things that I think your presentation brings out and where I think many people would strongly agree with you, Anastasia, is this point you're operating with, that sexuality is as a core part of our identities. So earlier in your lecture, in the introduction, you say, intrinsic to our nature, relevant to people of all ages throughout every era, sexuality encompasses who we are at our very core. And I fear Augustine would actually disagree. I think he sees sexuality as much more incidental. But regardless of whether I have that correct, if we hold to sexuality being to such a part of our core identity, then do we actually have the theological resources to make statements about the correctness or incorrectness of homosexual behavior? If homosexuality is a part of sexual identity that a homosexual person understands themselves to be that at their very core, is there any, if we accept that opening premise, do we have any theological resources to critique that? Thank you.
Yeah, it's a good question. I think that the way we as Christians can talk with culture on this is by emphasizing that Augustine, and I think we should be primarily concerned with not merely the person's sexuality, but the state of their soul and their citizenship in the heavenly city. So, one of the things that's really helpful here, I think, is to understand the difference of how the church fathers would have thought from us. And one of the things that's really important in this conversation is the idea of natural law. So the fathers would have, and this was termed by Aquinas later, but Augustine has these themes. And the natural law is essentially set up by God as a way in which life was intended to be, and it is our goal and should be something that we strive to understand how that natural law looks in our lives. So the idea is that it's like a moral guide by which we are led into making the right choices. And so that would have been really huge with Augustine and really important in the conversation because it points beyond sexual orientation and beyond identifying with someone's sexuality and tries to understand through reason how God originally intended the world to be. So I think that can help us understand kind of where Augustine's coming from, how we typically think of sexual orientation. He would have, I think, encouraged us to think about God's natural law and use that as our moral guide in this conversation rather than preference and, sexual orientation.
Thanks, Anastasia. Appreciate your work here and the clear descriptions you've given us. My question's pretty short. I was just thinking across what you presented, across the three moments in creation, in the pilgrimage, and then in new creation that you talked about with Augustine. And it strikes me, maybe similar to Dr. Armstrong, that it does feel like this is maybe a primarily negative account, mostly, of sexuality. In creation, it's mostly about a symbol for immaterial reality, two wills, or focus should be on the imago Dei, understood as the rational mind. So like the sexed body, at least, should not be considered as primary. In the kind of second moment in the earthly pilgrimage, the physical sexuality is real, you said, from Augustine, but it's dangerous and it needs restraint. So it's primarily a negative view. And it was the third moment where we talked about population of a future city that would maybe have a positive component perhaps to it, if I'm understanding the argument right. It's that last bit, I guess, maybe with Jonathan, I just might wonder if we could clarify from Augustine a little. I popped up in the City of God, that section where he makes this line. And let me, if I could just read three sentences, the one that was quoted and then the two others. I'm not sure if he's being as positive about this. Maybe you could help me on this. He says, this is what we quoted in the paper, as far as the race of mortals is concerned then, the coupling of male and female is the seedbed, as it were, of a city. And that's what you quoted. But he goes on to say, but the earthly city has need of this generation only, whereas the heavenly city has need of regeneration to escape the injury associated with generation. And I guess the question again is, that just doesn't sound, in my understanding, utterly positive. It sounds like he's saying that procreation coupling leads toward surely growth in the earthly city, but somehow regeneration is something other and better and overcoming in injury, which just sounds a little grumpier about how sexuality. So I'm just curious, what do you make of that? Does he have other moments that he talks more about population of the future city? What do we make of Augustine here? How positive is he on sexual difference?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Thank you. That's a really good question, and something that I wondered a lot about as I was reading, because it seems like there's this generally negative light cast over this conversation. I think something that a lot of scholars point to, and people I read that are a lot smarter than me, point to his influences and what was happening at the time. So he was surrounded by Platonism and the idea that matter's evil and that we should strive to, focus on what is not material. And then his influence, the influence of Manichaeism on his own life, which basically saw the world as this struggle between light and darkness, and bodies were seen as evil, and that was something that was prior to his conversion to Christianity. That was something that he was engulfed in. So he's coming out of that, and then even with his conversion, he's, I kind of talked about this, but holding on to this sexually promiscuous life, and doesn't see how he would ever be able to step out of that. And even at the point of his conversion, he hears this childlike voice, take up and read, and he flips to Romans. And it basically is this text that encourages people to refrain from desires, and he takes that to mean his sexual life. And so that, I think that's important to keep in mind. He's not living in a time like today where sexuality is kind of hypersexualized and celebrated, and it's really something that is valued when someone is open with their sexuality and talks about it a lot. So I think he's coming from a completely different era than we are, and that could play a lot into how he's going to talk about it later on, even since he was converted to Christianity. Other than that, like, I don't really know how to answer that, because there is a lot of this kind of negative light cast over what he's talking about.
Maybe just a very quick interpretive question then. Do you think, I mean, is it too strong of a judgment to wonder if those influences and maybe some of the milieu that you see him in there kind of cause him not to be able to offer a fully robust or as full of as we might want Christian account of sexuality? I mean, is he hindered a bit in that? Or do you think he's actually adding something to our account? I'm just curious what you make interpretively of him then.
I think he's adding like a soberness to the conversation that maybe is really helpful, and perhaps like a really realistic perspective on it. He talks about, in Confessions, it's has this potential for chaos, and he uses this like really negative language and says that it's like dangerous and chaotic and is prone to lead to misordered loves. And I think that could be really helpful in our modern context to kind of have like a reality check as to what is taking place within us. And I think we could like learn from that. And I don't think he provides all the answers. And I don't think he can maybe have the best theology of sexuality, but I think it's very helpful. I do think it's helpful to our context and provides a totally different perspective than we have.
All right, my question is related. So if he was bound by his context, we are as well. So reading through Augustine, did you see any principles that you thought could help us move the conversation forward? He may not offer answers to some of the questions you offer, but did he offer a start for developing a theology that you thought maybe could be useful to us today?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I think there are a lot of different aspects and a lot of things that were talked about tonight, a lot of different concepts relating to different areas of life. One of the most helpful ones that we could pull from this is the emphasis that he places on the individual soul and how that is kind of what he gets at again and again, and their allegiance to the heavenly city. And I think that that's really helpful in this conversation because it's really easy to think of people in terms of their sexuality alone. And I think, like I said, like culture it's very prevalent to identify with our sexuality and kind of cling to that. And for male or female or straight or gay, it's something that we're encouraged to cling to. And I think that Augustine would encourage us more to look within ourselves, to our loves and our affections, and kind of orient us in a different way and encourage us to focus on our love of God and people, and would, I think that could be a really useful thing when talking just with Christians and then with culture at large in this conversation.
Thank you. We'll move the questions to the floor. So Palmer will be coming around with the microphone if you want to raise your hand.
Hi, Anastasia. You did a really good job. Thanks for doing that. You got to always thank the person first before you ask the question. You said that Augustine, he interprets Galatians 3, let me check here, 27 and 28, which is talking about the distinctions, there's no distinction between Jew, Gentile, man, woman. And you said that Augustine kind of takes that passage and he uses that to say then that in heaven there's going to be no distinction between, man or woman, there'll be no sexual distinctions. And my question is, is that the only passage where he gets that from? So are there other passages where he uses that where he says that? And do you think that's the best interpretation of that passage today?
Thanks. So clarifying point, he doesn't think that there will be no sexes in heaven. He actually thinks that just in terms of salvation, in the salvation process, once we're in Christ, there's no distinction. But he thinks that sexual difference is something that it occurs as a present reality in the earthly pilgrimage, and he thinks that it will continue on into the eschaton. He's kind of fuzzy about like what that will look like. As far as I read, it's not super clear. He thinks that the sexes will be used in some type of heavenly worship, but as far as I know, like people kind of don't know what he means by that. But so that's just a clarifying point. They will continue, Augustine thinks, like in heaven.
Hey, Stasia. Excuse my voice, please. Great lecture. I spoke about what Augustine has to say about the virtue of celibacy and that lifestyle. And so I kind of have a two-part question. The first part being, assuming that you do actually see the virtue of celibacy, what way do you think we could revitalize that in the evangelical tradition? And then secondly, if we were to do so, do you think that we have not done so has in fact led to the problems that we are now facing in dialogues with issues like homosexuality, etc.?
That's a great question. I think that you're right in saying that it is maybe not talked about in the most helpful way in the church today. How could we revitalize it? That's a huge question. I think maybe talking about the purpose of it would be really helpful. I don't know about you guys, but growing up, it wasn't something that was talked about a lot in the church that I grew up in. And I've never heard it expressed like Augustine did, that it deals with like the internal life of an individual and how they can best love and serve God in terms of ordering of loves. So I think if we can just get the conversation going more, it might help revitalize it, as you say. I think having conversations like this is helpful. I don't know like beyond that what I could say about how to bring it about, but certainly having more well-rounded theology of it could come out in our churches and encourage people to think differently about it than has been typically thought. The second question, can you restate the second question one more time?
Think that if within evangelicalism, if we had a developed theology of celibacy, that would make it more easy for us to address in a natural way how someone relates to their sexuality, particularly in considering issues of homosexuality.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a really good point and a really good question. I think part of the problem with this conversation is that specifically within churches, when someone has same-sex attraction or identifies as being homosexual, the church doesn't really have a category or a way of handling that helpfully, I don't think. So I think that that is a correct assessment, because if we had a way of thinking and talking about it and a way for people in the church who do identify as gay, for them to have a safe place of community and fellowship and friendship without being in a partnership with someone, that it would completely change Christians' reactions to having same-sex attraction. But as of yet, I don't think, at least from the churches that I've seen and been a part of and conversations I've had, that's not something that's really occurring in the evangelical church today. And I think that's really sad and something that really ought to be encouraged and brought about so that people have a safe place and those conversations can be had.
Anastasia and Caleb, can I just add in and say, I think you're both making a very, very important point that I think Augustine probably in heaven is really excited about this part of the presentation. How would you revitalize celibacy for the evangelical movement? Because I think that Augustine would agree that one of the diseases of North American evangelical Christianity is we share our culture's idolization of sexuality. Yeah. So that sets things off balance. And your youth pastors aren't going to tell you that sex actually a lot of the time really isn't even very cool, because they all want you to stay chaste and get through their program. So I think it's... So a lot of people are not going to actually talk openly and thoughtfully about sexuality. So I think, rather than just citing the negative things about sexuality, what would actually give traction to the movement is to do a positive theology of celibacy. I think that's brilliant.
Maybe one other book, if you want to read something. Wes Hill's Spiritual Friendship, recent book on this, is pretty fabulous, actually. He would self-identify as a homosexually oriented Christian, but he's celibate, and he writes a book about what spiritual friendship could look like in the church for someone like him. Quite a good book to look at.
It's Asia. So one interesting phrase that kind of stuck out to me in your lecture from Augustine is this equality of the mind between men and women. And I've often heard from evangelical pastors, and may have even said it myself, that when I speak about the Bible, about men and women, I tend to say, well, we're wired differently, and I point to my mind. Would Augustine say anything to that?
To the wiring?
Yeah, as in, like, not the physicality, no. But the that we might be equal in our reasoning, but do we reason differently?
I don't know. I didn't read stuff on that. That's an interesting question. I don't think, you know, I think he probably would have recognized that there are differences that take place between men and women, and in their mind, the way that they reason. All I can say from what I read and on the text where he talks about equality of the mind is that that's something that he emphasizes, but I'm not sure about actually how we reason, what he would have to say on that. But good question.
Hi, Anastasia.
Hi.
Okay, so you said on in his literal comment or his commentary against the Manichees, he thinks that it's literal when it says that there are two genders. So there's a literal meaning, and there's a second meaning where the two genders are conflicting wills in a soul. Am I getting that right? Okay. Mm-hmm. Exegetically or philosophically, how did he reach that conclusion?
He says at one point, that he takes it from the woman being made from the man, and that's kind of where he gets this idea that it must signify more. And this is kind of like, this is common to Augustine to, you know, allegorize and look beyond what's literally happening. I think he, yeah, from what I read, he clung on to that phrase, bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh, and he saw that it has to mean something more. I don't know why he reached that conclusion, but yeah, he points to the rational will and the fleshly will and the submission that takes place, and the fight that those two wills have, and the one that must be submissive to the other. But I'm not sure how he directly comes to that just from bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh.
Hi, Stasia. I have a question. So people like Mel Mel White and Matthias, a few guys that I sent you, who would identify as gay Christians or homosexual Christians, would say that the church fathers didn't have the idea of what's going on right now. They didn't have the mindset. They didn't understand. How do you think Augustine would respond today to that? How would he act out on church members or church splits or different things like that going on inside the church right now? What do you think he will act on from your view of reading him on sexuality? How do you think he would respond to this today?
How would he respond specifically to people being gay and Christian?
Yeah, how do you think he would respond to orientation specifically in the church?
So. Yeah, that's a really good question. And that's something that a lot of people take issue with, but not even in the question of sexuality, in the question of why do we read the church fathers? They were talking about things that we're not talking about now. They're not as relevant. They don't have the same mindset that we have. And I have a couple of answers on that, but just broadly speaking, I guess, the church fathers and Augustine on sexuality has thought through it really deeply and theologically and is coming at it from a really different angle. So I don't think that is a reason to not look at him. I think that's a reason to look at him and to read deeper into what he says. Just like it's valuable to have conversations with people that are coming from different cultures or whatever. And then I think Augustine wouldn't have used the language of orientation. It probably wasn't even in use in the same way that it is now in our churches. And I think that's because orientation deals a lot with let me put it this way. To go back to the idea of like a natural law that Augustine would have been operating out of, he would have seen God's ideal as what he should strive for, and God, how God originally intended the world to be what Christians should think of as using as their moral guide to understand how we should act. So he would look, I think, at someone who is gay and a Christian as a perversion of how God originally intended the created order to act. And this is along with like masturbation and pornography, that it's a diversion from how God originally intended the world to live and to be. And for that reason, it's wrong. So the language of orientation is something really recently developed and emphasized in modernity. And so he kind of would have been operating out of a totally different mindset. But I think he would say that, it's like a perversion of the good and how God created the world, and that it's also a love of self above a love of God, because it is not clinging to God's purpose for the sexes.
Okay, I have a quick question. I just wanted to ask first for clarification. At the end, I'm just trying to make sure I was understanding correctly. Were you trying to show us how Augustine gives us principles to handle this discussion today? I perceived at the end that you were trying to do that. Am I correct?
Yes.
Okay, because I felt like I went away without clarity. I didn't know what principles exactly, or how would Augustine have us discuss this today, because I felt a little, I don't know, without clarity. Thank you.
Yeah. Part of that is the nature of ending on asking questions more than providing answers, and that's a little bit intentional because I don't, there are a lot of question marks to how this exactly integrates with our modern context. But I think in terms of implementing principles of Augustine's theology in our modern context, there are a handful of them, but things that we talked about with like celibacy, I think is really important. The ordering of loves in the individual, regardless of sexuality, I think is really important. I think even the emphasis on procreation in order to populate the heavenly city is a really interesting and fascinating concept that I think that could help us understand the creation of God or the decree by God to multiply in the earth. So I think those are a few of the principles, but also I'm encouraging dialogue and asking questions in this because I think there are a lot of them.
So this kind of goes with part of what you just said. So you mentioned that one of Augustine's main beliefs regarding sexuality was to reproduce. You mentioned that this view is supposed to take place in the city of God. So is this specifically speaking of heaven? And then what does this mean? Does this mean that we are to produce earthly children and raise them to follow God? Or does it mean we're to produce spiritual children or something different than both of those?
Yeah. Probably Dr. Armstrong can help me with this, but I think that the heavenly city is kind of this combination of the present life with heaven. I don't know if that's a correct reading.
Sadly, I can't be of much positive help here too, Anastasia. So like in his treatise there on the benefits of marriage, he's got a straw man argument against himself. And he says, well, if somebody has such a view of sex as mine, then they'd say, well, the population of the earth will die out. And he says, bring it on so Jesus can get back. So I don't know where that idea is resourced either.
Stacia, I'm so proud of you. Excellent job. My question is not as detailed. It's more so just wondering what inspired you to study this topic of Augustine's perspective on sexuality. I was there in the beginning when you initially wrote maybe a 10-page paper on just surface level what Augustine thought, and now you've dove in. So I'm wondering what inspired you to continue, and also would you share with us what one of the major points you took away in your personal life was in studying Augustine's thoughts? What have you come away with?
Thanks. Well, I took an amazing class with Dr. Armstrong on Augustine my first year at U. That kind of sparked my interest. I don't even remember how the topic of his views on sexuality came out, but time rolled around, Athanasius lecture, and that was one of the only topics in school that I felt was really like really fascinating and really pertinent to today. And I had a conversation with Dr. Malone, and he recommended this book to me. And it's kind of an assessment of what Augustine thinks, and that was super helpful. And I think probably it's a hard question about like the biggest thing that I've kind of taken from this theology, but I think the idea that it's much more nuanced than we think. And it's not so cut and dry as I've tended to think, and I think that the church tends to say it is. There are more issues taking place than just someone's orientation towards a sexuality. And then along with that, his emphasis on the individual's love of God as being kind of the most significant aspect of an individual. So he kind of looks at every person regardless of sexuality and almost like first orients towards their citizenship in which city and focuses on that and comes back to that idea again and again. And I think that that's really important for us today when we have this conversation to not ignore sexual differences and to recognize how we are different and wrestle through those things, but also look at our interior state and how our soul is directed towards God or if it's not. And I think that that's really helpful, especially in the larger context of culture and understanding how we're supposed to engage with people on this topic.
And can I just add to Anastasia, I'm personally very grateful that you've done this. I think everybody in the room is very grateful that you've done this lecture. You've spoken graciously to a very difficult topic, and I think it's been very useful. So I'm personally very glad you did.
Hey, Stasia. Thanks for your lecture. I think you did a really great job. I'm wondering, in dialogue with a Christian homosexual who is practicing that lifestyle, whether or not you think it would be necessary to have a conversation with them about that, and then as well, if it was, like maybe how you would go about that.
So is this like personally, like what I think about it, or?
Yes.
Yeah, that's really difficult, and in a lot of ways, I think situational. I would ask a lot of questions and be really gracious in how I talk about it and try to understand maybe where they're coming from in terms of like history and even ask them like, you know, so like a lot of Christians maybe would like disagree. Why do you think it's okay to, you know, be a practicing homosexual, and kind of like first understand so then you can know how to address that and like engage with them in that. I mean, that's really hard, and I wouldn't know. Maybe it depends, like, you know, how are these, is this person like a recent Christian? Is that, were they gay and then became Christian or vice versa? I think like all those things play into how I would talk to someone about it. But like, I would say like Augustine, and it is probably first concerned with the person's state of salvation beyond their sexual orientation. And I think that it's probably I think that it's important to know if that person is, I mean, you said they're a Christian, so I guess that kind of answers that. But it's really hard. I would say that, like, it honestly takes a lot of prayer and a lot of like thought and caution and like sensitivity to engaging with someone on that. And I wouldn't encourage someone not to. I would say that like, especially with like close friendships, that's something that can be like really helpful and healing and for both ends. But as to how exactly to go about that, I think it's probably case by case and by the Spirit's help. Thank you.
There we are. In light of the last two questions, I appreciate your carefulness in engaging a person, or at least this hypothetical person. More specifically, I was talking with a friend a couple months ago, and we got onto the topic of homosexuality. And first, it was more general speaking, and how do we approach this, and how do we engage this? And we spoke of a lot of the same types of principles we go through, and like the image of God. What does that look like? But then it kind of came to this turn where he knows of this lesbian, or at least someone who identifies as a lesbian, and she is in a relationship with another girl, and they both love the Lord so much, and they both mirror godly character from almost like a universal. Horizontal level, I guess, like just from person to person. And he's like, I actually have a really hard time even thinking about this in a negative light because they genuinely look like they love God, and it's a hard experientially to feel like this is sin when I see them do it so well. And he again is just confirming this caution and this carefulness that he has toward that, and the kind of the subjectivity toward this like case by case situations. And so in your presentation, you seem that you, Augustine almost calls us to not look toward our sexuality or to the natural aspect of it, not saying that it's not important, but that our primary importance is to our citizenship in heaven. And having said that, is it okay if we are primarily if these two lesbians, I have no idea who they are, but if these two lesbians are in a relationship and their primary citizenship is heavenward in every sense of the word, how do we really engage that? Or how do we consider that? Or how do we even, process that? Because it almost seems, or some can take some of those principles that you presented from Augustine to say that oh well, since they love the Lord and that's obvious, then we shouldn't be concerned about that, or should we then approach and say like this is natural law, or maybe if that doesn't ring clear here in our day, how do we engage that in a 21st century century context, saying that we don't follow natural law anymore, for whatever reason, and like so what would you appeal to today? What kind of a argument or angle or perspective would you share? That maybe has a relevance to a person in that situation. And this can be open to the panelists as well. Just thinking in a practical sense. Thank you.
That's good. I mean, that's a hard question, and that's difficult because if they're like displaying unity and love, those are like a lot of Christian virtues, and those are things that are celebrated and are encouraged in the church. I think if they were probably like open to dialogue and like asking what I thought about it, then I'd probably take it down the route of God's intention for humanity and how he created them. And I would look at like the creation story probably and use that as kind of my guide for how, a perversion of that. I would probably take that as from that angle.
Check. I just wanted to agree with Anastasia that I think the right role would be to ask questions. So I think one of the fundamental insights of the modern view towards sexuality is to recognize its plasticity. Sexuality can look very, very different. So it would be hard to come to any relationship immediately and know what needs to be fixed, any relationship. So I would agree to ask some questions, and probably as you ask those questions and work with that person, respond pastorally as you would probably to any relationship. So what's motivating this? How's it working? How is this an expression of true love, I think?
Anastasia's goal in her talk was to invite questions and to not necessarily close the discussion, definitely not close the discussion, but to invite people to continue thinking. So I think we'll take one more question and then hope that you will continue conversations with Anastasia and with each other later and continue to think through some of these difficult issues.
Thank you, Stage. My question, and I'm just going to read it to you, is, for Augustine, what is the significance of the fall causing us to cover our bodies? And when sin entered the world, why was it suddenly shameful or sinful for our sexual differences to be on display? And what does this say about the goodness of our bodies? What would Augustine say? Well, I don't know if you looked into this at all.
Can you say the first one again?
Yeah. It's kind of all the same question. I just stated it a lot. What is the significance of the fall causing us to cover our bodies?
Can you say the other two? Sorry.
When sin entered the world, why did it become shameful or sinful for our sexual differences to be on display? And what does that say about the goodness of our bodies and our sexual differences?
I am not sure what Augustine would say in regards to why we cover up those body parts and why that was something that took place after the fall and after sin entered. I don't recall reading anything on that, like, specifically. And what's interesting is that I can totally see, even from your question, and I'm trying to think back to what I've read about, like, the physical body, he had, like, a generally negative concept. So the things that I can remember, like, he references the body as being beautiful, but he states that that's not where significant human meaning resides. I think apart from procreation, which he emphasizes, I don't know what goodness Augustine would attribute to the physical body. With it, he does emphasize in other works how we experience God through our body, and he sees it as a necessary means for the earthly pilgrimage. But in terms of, like, sexuality, I'm not sure what he would attribute to its goodness. That's a really good question. And then I don't know about the covering of those parts either. How that is particularly significant in the fall.
Anastasia, we all loved it. So would you give Anastasia a big round of applause? Go in peace and be here next time for Mike Kibbe's lecture, March 18th. Thanks a lot, everybody. Thank you, Anastasia, especially.